I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. We're bringing together experts, thinkers, and leaders, busting myths, sharing stories, and staying connected when Canadians need it the most. We're having unexpected conversations for unprecedented times. Hi, everyone. Today, I am with a woman that needs no introduction, Arlene Dickinson. Arlene, how are you doing today?
I'm great, thank you. How about you?
Yeah, I'm pretty good. You know, spending a lot of time in my basement talking to interesting people like you that can really help give us some tips. And I'm excited to talk to you because you've been through a crisis before, and you are someone that everyone looks up to when it comes to entrepreneurs and, you know, the business community. And so really looking forward to picking your brain on this. I'm curious as to, you know, you speak a lot about resilience, and I talk a lot about resilience, but when it comes to your healthcare and stuff, tell me about resilience and being an entrepreneur.
Well, I think, you know, resilience is something we talk about all the time. As you said, you know, persistence, resilience, tenacity, these are words that are used a lot when you're talking about entrepreneurialism and how to kind of weather the storms. And it's funny, I actually posted on my LinkedIn yesterday, I was thinking about it, thinking that leaders in today and entrepreneurs today are really in uncharted waters. And you know, people look to leaders in times of crisis in particular, as we're talking about the flood, or in this case, you know, what we're dealing with the health pandemic that's going on. People look to leaders to be calm and, you know, and to demonstrate, you know, to stand out front and to be ahead of everything and to be honest and transparent and to make sure that they're, you know, telling, you know, bad news at the same time that they're helping people understand that there's a path forward. And so resilience is about being that type of leader. But what I said in my post is that what people sometimes don't realize is that inside, the leader is experiencing a lot of fear themselves because they don't know necessarily what they're doing. I mean, I've certainly never dealt with a pandemic before. And so there's new things that you have to think about. And I likened it to, you know, when you're on an airplane and the ride gets bumpy, you know, people will look to the flight attendant to make sure that they're calm and collected, because if they're sitting there calm and collected, then things are fine, right? So it's kind of what leadership is like. But meanwhile, that, you know, the flight attendant might have just peed their pants a little because they are afraid, right?
So yeah, that's a really good way of putting it. I can visualize that. And you're right, when you're on a flight and, you know, things get bumpy, I calm down immediately if everyone around me is calm.
That's right. That's right. And I think that's, so resilience is being able to demonstrate that you can come back in the face of, you know, what can be, you know, crisis or what can be difficult choices. And I think, you know, this is, I think to be resilient, you have to have optimism. And optimism to me is something that is understated as it relates to being an entrepreneur. You have to be almost a pragmatic optimist in times like this. You have to be cautious and careful, but you have to be able to bounce back, and that takes optimism. And I think right now people are looking for hope and optimism from their leaders.
Do you think we're doing a good job of that?
I do think that. I've been watching the governments across the country. In particular, I've watched our prime minister, and you know, I really respect the ability to stand up in front of Canadians every day and talk us through what we're actually doing about this, because that's exactly what we all need. We need to know the facts, and you know, we've got scientists and health authorities giving us the facts, and then we've got leaders who are standing up and telling us what they're actually doing to help us through this. So, you know, one side I get and understand what's happening, on the other side I can see how, what the solutions are that are coming, and that gives me hope. And I do think that we've done a good job, especially compared to other countries who I think have not fared quite as fortunately as we have with their leadership.
Yeah, I've heard a lot of people say, boy, oh boy, am I glad I live in Canada. I'm hearing a lot of that right now. Yeah. So let's talk about a new entrepreneur. So somebody who is, you know, I'm sure there are thousands of people across the country who are, you know, just, they have their idea and they were just getting ready to, you know, launch something, and now this has happened. What do you do if you're in this position?
I think that's probably one of the the businesses that are going to be most impacted by this. And those are the early stage, early growth companies that are just starting to get going. You know, they've been in business a year or two. They're starting to see revenue, or they're just getting to a place where they think they can build their business up. And, you know, they may not be profitable yet. They may have not gotten, you know, the traction yet to really be able to withstand a lot of punches that you would take in the marketplace. And so those companies in particular, I am most concerned with. And those are the companies that I'm spending most of my time with, frankly, these early stage, early growth companies. And so to them, I would say, you know what, this is a time to lean on your mentors, lean on your vendors and your partners, talk to them, help you get through it. In other words, the more transparent you can be with them about what's happening, the more support you're going to get. And also there's a lot of resources out there, certainly with some of the financial institutions that are trying to support these businesses. But go to your investors, go to your family and friends, go to people who have been supporting you, and ask for them to continue to support, because those are the businesses that I think are going to be impacted the most.
If you're a seasoned entrepreneur, somebody who, you know, has started many businesses, or, you know, you're this is, you know, what you do, you're an entrepreneur, are they nervous too, or can they ride this wave easier than others?
If you're
an experienced entrepreneur, somebody.
Oh, geez, no. I'm sorry. I. You know what? Yes. Can they ride it easier? No. I mean, I think that's why I wrote the book that I wrote, because at the end of the day, you know, you can't. I was 30 years in business when that flood hit in Calgary. You know, I thought I had seen it all, and, you know, weathered all sorts of storms, and probably there was not much that was going to happen that could surprise me. And then a flood hit. And so, you know, I think absolutely experience maybe makes you calmer, but it also means that you probably don't have as much runway ahead of you to correct things. So it's a different type of problem solving. You have the ability to look back on your past and understand that you can get through things, but you also are charting and facing things you've never seen before. So I think it is different. It's probably in some respects, you know, sometimes experience can be a bad thing. I'm just thinking out loud a little bit here, because it is a podcast.
It's good.
You know, I think sometimes experience can be a bad thing, because you tend to go revert back to your tried and true way of doing things, right? You tend to go, well, this is what worked before, so I'm going to do that again. And you may not be as open to thinking about things in a different way and to reinventing yourself into what, and the business, what it can be. So I think it takes, you have to get stuck out of that mud you're in and get stuck out of the rut you have actually probably been in for many years in business without even knowing you're in that rut. So I think keeping an open mind is important.
I think there might be a misconception to somebody like you, or somebody, you know, that has been, you know, an entrepreneur, business leader for so long, that you're super wealthy, you have tons of money, and you don't have anything to worry about. Whereas the little person, you know, is risking losing everything. What about that train of thought?
Yeah, you know, listen, I've had no money, and I've had money, and certainly I am very grateful that I am in a place, in a position where I'm not, you know, certainly as concerned about whether I have to be, I can put food on the table anymore, but I don't forget that. Mm-hmm. I've never forgotten that. I've never forgotten what that felt like. And I've always been, you know, I think this is the time where people who do have wealth need to dig deep and reach back out and help others. And I'm seeing a lot of that. And, you know, there's a leveling out that's happening in the world. And, you know, the disparity between those who have and don't have has grown too wide. And so I do think that there is an opportunity for all of us to take a moment and reconsider who we are, what we want in our lives, to think about, you know, the things that are of value to us, and to reshift the future of this planet. And that is, aren't we lucky that we have that opportunity to do that? It would be a shame if we all just throw it away when this goes away, which I really believe it will. When this fades away, will the memory of what we are all thinking about fade with it? And I hope not.
You know, that is, I was thinking about that exact thing yesterday, because what I've noticed, and I'm sure you have too, is this has really shown us some people's true colors, you know, like we're seeing how companies are reacting, how they're stepping up, how people are stepping up to help others. And other people, you're really seeing who they truly are. And it might not be such a good thing. Have you seen any of that? Or have you seen all good, you know?
No, I have seen, you know, it's interesting because sometimes social media is a good tell on how people are dealing with things, right? And so I still kind of shake my head a little bit when I see people posting what I think are potentially not as, I don't want to sound judgmental, so I'm going to be careful here.
Yeah.
I guess what I'm trying to say is how you show up right now. You know, I've tended to go more to the humor side of things. I mean, I've been trying to post things about, you know, government assistance and where you can get help and those things. But I think right now we need to have some hope and optimism. And so I'm trying to post more optimistic things. And, you know, I've stopped posting, you know, here's a picture of me at a party. And I never was a real big poster.
Yeah.
Party,
you know?
but, you know, like I do think we need to really, really consider, especially people who have a platform of any kind, what the messages we're putting out there. And, again, not to judge, because everybody needs to live their own life and everybody needs to do what they need to do and to be honest with themselves. And so who knows what motivates anybody to do anything. And it's not my place to judge them. I think we'd all do better in the world if we just kind of just got on with ourselves, being the best people we can be ourselves.
Yeah, very good advice. I agree. Can you walk me through the Calgary flood and tell me what that was like for you? I know it was completely unexpected. And what did it do to your business? And where did it put you after that flood?
You know, well, when the flood happened, as I said, I'd been in business for 30 years. And it was a kind of a venture communications, my marketing firm, was something that had really, I'd grown up with it in business. I'd grown up with it in terms of my own personal career. And I had gone on to, you know, start a fund called District Ventures, which is now a $100 million fund that invests in food and health wellness companies. And I had, you know, venture was kind of on, I guess, automatic, you know, like I loved the company, but it wasn't what I was doing full time. And I had a great team managing it. And I guess I took my eye off the ball. And so when the flood hit, it really blindsided all of us. And it was really difficult. And it made me reassess everything in my life and made me realize that I had, you know, I hadn't paid enough attention. I wasn't, you know, showing up as the leader I wanted to show up as. And so what I had to do, and I outlined it in the book, I decided to use the same fundamentals that I use in helping businesses, the same strategy and strategic framework that I use to help businesses, that we could apply that to ourselves. And in the process, I ended up applying it to myself as well. So it wasn't just the business that changed, it was me that changed. And it was an interesting journey because I was just starting out to raise the fund when all of this happened. And I kind of talk about it in the context of four different things people can take away. And the first one is that it's a little bit, the process is a little bit counterintuitive. In other words, you have to look back in order to look forward. Mm. Businesses are good at that. They can look back and say, okay, we did that wrong and the process was wrong, so let's fix that so we don't make that same mistake again. People, not so much. We don't like looking back at ourselves.
So true.
It's ugly, right?
Yeah.
We don't want to see all that stuff we did and really face ourselves. And we don't really spend time with ourselves. And so looking back to figure out what got you in the rut in the first place means kind of taking away the layers of who you are and why you did the things you did, and not to judge yourself, but to understand yourself. And then the next thing I talk about is, you know, currency, which is finding what it is you're good at. And everybody is good at something. You know, we talk about this all the time, but sometimes people live in other people's shadows because they feel marginalized because their other person's voice is larger than theirs or bigger than theirs. And finding your currency is so important. I often use the example that, you know, somebody might say, well, the only thing I'm really good at is baking cookies. And I would say, yes. And Mrs. Fields said the same thing. So, you know, like it could be anything that you can do that you are really good at that could actually be your currency. And it could be that you're kind. It could be that you're, it could be many things.
And then you're right. We all have something.
We all have a talent. We all have a talent. And we are so used to escalating and elevating other people's talents that sometimes we harbor inside of us an unrealized voice of what we're capable of. And so I would encourage people to think about what they're good at or what they, you know, what
right.
they
But Arlene, do you are. Think that's more of a, is that something that women do more often than men?
I think men
lift other people up. You know what I mean? And to, you said something, you said not to judge yourself. Boy, that's hard to do.
Yeah. I think men are more practical about it than women are.
Interesting.
You know, I think men are more practical about kind of, I'm good at these things and that's when I'm going to apply that. And women, you're right. Women tend to be, you know, we are the caregivers and the kind of the nurturers, generally. And that is in of itself a talent. And that in and of itself is what makes female leaders so strong, I believe, is that they can apply their empathy and their nurturing skills to their intelligence. And so I think it is different for sure. I mean, and then I talk a little bit about, you know, core purpose. I know we always talk in life about finding your passion, but I actually think it's your purpose that's more important. And purpose meaning, you know, what it is that kind of gets you up every day, your why. You know, because if you find your why, then that is going to ultimately also be your passion. But if you just look for something you love to do, it doesn't really mean that there's a why behind doing it. I could love to golf, but there's no purpose in golfing. I'm never going to be a professional golfer, trust me. But I could be passionate about it. But I do think finding your why, what's going to get you out of bed every day, matters. And then the final thing I talk about is context. What's going on in the world around you, and how do you take your past and your currency and your purpose and apply it in today's world? And man, that's never been more necessary than it is today, where we are all kind of shaking our heads a little bit and wondering what we want to do with our lives now.
Oh gosh, it's so true. And yeah, the not to judge yourself. Gosh, that is, that's something, it's a good thing to think about while we're all in self-isolation. And do you think there's opportunity here for people that maybe aren't, you know, entrepreneurs, but they find themselves at home and maybe have a good idea? Is this an opportunity for people?
Yeah, for sure it is. I think it's an opportunity to, again, reassess the busyness of our lives. You know, one of the things I've noticed, I don't know about you, but for me, my pace is different, and I'm finding that I have time to think through problems and really consider things, you know, and that's been kind of everybody's, you know, concern since the world has gotten so fast and so furious, and I go from meeting to meeting to meeting and, you know, job to job to job, and I never have time to think. And now we're given this gift of time and slowness and having to spend time with ourselves. And I try to look at it that way, as a gift. I'm an introvert anyhow, so I do tend to spend a lot of time when I'm not in the public by myself. But I do think that this is a time for us all to reassess what we want for our futures and to apply. And yes, if you have a great idea, you bet, you know, think it through, and maybe you can bring something to the world that the world hadn't thought about before.
Yeah, it's true. And with everybody doing all these, you know, online meetings, I think that people have discovered that, oh, guess what? We can do this in the comfort of our home. I had a board meeting last night in my basement, you know, at home, and there were 10 of us on a Zoom call, and we had an emergency board meeting, and it was for a nonprofit that I'm a part of. And it was amazing what we got done an hour of a Zoom meeting. Yeah. So I think people are starting to really discover that, like, wow, we can do things differently. And, you know, how many times have we asked somebody, how are you doing, Arlene? Oh, I'm so busy. I'm so busy. It's so busy. And we're not saying that as much right now, are we?
No, we're now just trying to sort through how to be more as productive as we were without having the tools all around us. And we are learning to use great new, thank goodness the digital tools exist that do exist. I mean, I love some of the stuff we're doing and using, and I feel very connected. I actually feel more connected in some respects to the team than I did when we were all in the same office or building together.
I think a lot of people are feeling that way. Yeah. How's Alberta doing through this?
Alberta's not doing well through this for a whole bunch of reasons. I mean, the energy sector was already had taken a huge hit and continues to take a huge hit. And then on top of that, of course, the pandemic. So I think, you know, but Albertans are an entrepreneurial and innovative group of people. And I feel confident that we will come out of this with new ideas and new innovations and ways to move forward. And you know, there was already a lot going on in Alberta relative to clean tech and relative to trying to transition the, you know, the energy sector into a new economy. And I believe this will just speed that up. And, you know, there are certainly the people who are on one side of the fence on that and the people on the other side of the fence on that. But at the end of the day, the sun shines on all of us the same. And so we've got to stop thinking about sides and start figuring out how to collaborate and work together towards a new future in Alberta.
Absolutely. And mental health, I know this is something that is really important to you. I think it's, you know, really becoming, it's something that we're talking about more and more. And this is really shining a light on it because isolation is hard. For the average person, let alone if you're dealing with mental health challenges. What about mental health in the business community through this?
Yeah, you know, I was interviewed on CBC a while ago. They were asking, you know, what's the number one challenge that I think Canadians are going to face and that we need to focus on for the future. And I said it was mental health. Mm. And I believe that because we were getting more isolated even before this happened. We were becoming more antisocial. You know, everything was on a phone or on you know, over in a different way. You know, it was like we were almost protecting ourselves from communication in a meaningful way because everything was shorthand and texts and, you know, short little bursts of communication, but not real meaningful exchanges. Mm-hmm. And I found, you know, about 6 months ago, I started to experience anxiety for the first time in my life. And I had gone my whole life not having anxiety and had, you know, people very close to me who did have it. And I never really understood it. I used to think, well, just, you know, what are you anxious about? Like, there's nothing going on. Like, what is causing the anxiety? And I started to get it. And you know what? It's really debilitating. It's really mm-hmm. difficult to deal with. And it's very challenging. And I really started to understand, you know, that and many other mental health issues because I, you know, we struggled with that in some of my family members my whole life. So I've witnessed it. And lately I've experienced it with anxiety, and I think we have to figure out how to get more communicative, and we have to be more transparent and willing to share when we are challenged. You know, people look at me and say, well, you're a dragon. How could you have anxiety? I have anxiety, and I am okay to say I have anxiety, and I've learned to deal with it. And I thank often, and I don't have shares in the company. I wish I did, but Calm owes me some sort of a, you know, like a app for life or something because I talk
agree.
About it
me
all
too.
The time. I love that app and it's helped me enormously.
We use it a lot in our house too. We do even with the kids, right? It's
yes.
just a great, it's a great,
fabulous.
It's a great thing to teach kids now, right? That, you know, how to calm yourself, how to step out and, you know, and meditate or just breathe, like remembering to breathe through
yes.
things. Really
yes.
important.
I mean, I'd say the three things that I have focused on for mental health that I think businesses can focus on. We actually ended up giving Calm as a free 1 year subscription and a mental health day to everybody that was on our team. Because we, you know, it is important. And I said to everybody, you know, use this app and figure out, we also do a wellness allowance where we give people a wellness allowance once a year and they can apply it for whatever type of wellness they want. So businesses can do things, whether it's wellness allowances, whether it's giving people the Calm app to help them understand, whether it's just saying, you know, take a mental health day whenever you need a mental health day. It doesn't have to be a holiday day or a sick day. There's things we can do as businesses to, and, you know, try and have more social time together where they, maybe you shut, we for years have done a thing called beers and cheers where we shut down the office once a week on every Thursday at 4 o'clock. And we just sit and have food and drinks together and, you know, it could be water, it could be juice, it could be wine. You know, we don't sit, it's not a big party. It's just simply a social hour. And we've done that for now 34 years, every
wow.
Thursday. And I miss that. It's funny. I miss that we can't do that. But what my team has done is now they do it virtually. So they continue on the tradition and they're doing it virtually. So there are things businesses need to do, and they need to acknowledge the stress people are under. And sometimes as leaders, you don't see it. And we do need to be paying much more attention to it.
Yeah, that's a really good point, because you also never know what's going on at home for somebody too, right? And now we're all forced to be home, whatever that may look like. And it's not the same for everybody. So that's really good advice for business leaders to consider doing something like that. So when we're talking about advice for new entrepreneurs, you've been involved with so many things where, you know, handing out money to new entrepreneurs, you know, including the TELUS Pitch. You were a part of that.
Yes.
Why are things like that, you know, the TELUS Pitch or Dragon's Den, why are things like that important? What do they show people?
Well, you know, the TELUS Pitch, I've really enjoyed the partnership that I've had with TELUS. And I do, you know, I know this wasn't part of what we talked about at all, mm-hmm. but I do want to pass on that the kudos to TELUS, because right now through all of this, you know, you're offering a lot of support to people in their homes and businesses, and you're doing a lot of things right to support people through this. And I know that's putting a lot of strain on the organization, any organization that's trying to do support essential services. So very grateful for the relationship I have with TELUS. I thought the small business pitch and being part of that and continuing to be part of that has been very meaningful to me, because we've had so many applications from people who have great ideas, and, you know, and you're a facilitator of that. And as an organization, that's another example of what people can do to help amplify a contest into something that actually starts to get into the zeitgeist around celebrating small business and celebrating people who have ideas. And that's what Dragon's Den is as well. You know, it's saying to people, you know, have that idea, be brave enough to stand up and pitch it to people. And yeah, maybe you won't get money, but you know, like there's lots of people that didn't get money on Dragon's Den that went on to do amazing things. And they did it because they used it as a springboard into the future. Mm-hmm. And so I love that we encourage this notion of innovation and creativity and telling people to think outside the box and do things differently. And mm-hmm. and TELUS has done that, and certainly Dragon's Den does that.
Can you give me a way or a suggestion of how in this climate we can, as Canadians, we can support our small businesses? Is there a way we can do that? If maybe our small business down the street where we usually get our, you know, our Sunday night dinner or whatever it might be is closed now, or are there ways that we can support through anything?
Absolutely, there are. There's gift cards. You can buy gift cards. So if you normally would have spent money going to that restaurant or going to that coffee shop or going to, you know, getting your nails done or getting a massage, just in particular, think about personal caregiver, you know, workers that are out there, the people that were doing on those types of services, they are getting very hard hit. And so you can continue to pay them. If you are in a position where you're still getting paid and you're living your life still other than you're at home, but you're fortunate enough to continue to have a job and be employed and have the ability to carry on, then I certainly have been either buying gift cards or, you know, sending them, you know, money saying, thank you. I would have normally gone to get my nails done right now, but I can't get my nails done right now. So here, you know, here I'm going to pay you for it anyhow. It's things like that that we can all do, and that will help these businesses survive. So buy gift cards, prepay as if you were going, you know, and use the gift
brilliant.
Card.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very good. And, you know, a lot of people leaving thank you notes and thanking of you notes too, because it is, it's a lonely time for a lot of people. When we look at, you know, we'll start to wrap this conversation up, but just, you know, what the Prime Minister announced with the, you know, the 75% wage subsidy. And I mean, things are changing, right? Every day we wake up and there's a new announcement or there's new developments. Are these good things what our government is doing right now, trying to put in place for small businesses, nonprofits, all that sort of stuff?
Yes. I think they're not only good, they're imperative. And I am proud that our government is stepping up to do that across provincial and you know, for provincial and federally. I think the governments are all doing what they can to support the citizens of this country. And I believe the measures that they took last week around the 75% of salaries and helping charities and not-for-profits and doing the things they've done relative to the loans that they've given out, the $40,000 loan, these things are going to keep people employed and they're going to continue to keep the economy going in the face of what right now is uncertainty as to when this is going to be over. So I am very grateful for small businesses. I mean, there's a couple things I'd like to maybe just say, if you don't mind. One of them is I'm very grateful for what the government's doing. Super grateful for what healthcare workers are doing. Holy smokes. Like it's astounding to me the sacrifices they're making and the things they're doing. So I am very grateful. And I don't want to, not just healthcare workers, but you know, they truly are on the front line of fighting this. But everyone who's providing essential services and everyone, grocery store workers, delivery people, you know, restaurants that are supplying and supporting food, companies that are taking their existing assembly lines and turning them into factories, like to create masks and respirators and ventilators and the things that are happening at a very basic human level give me hope. And I'm grateful.
I'm very grateful too. And it's really, it shined a light on just how resilient we are and how, you know, we can be team players and really step up for Canadians. And I like what you said about, you know, trying to be optimistic about it on social media and supportive. Those are all really important things because that's how we get through hard times really and learn to be resilient, right? Because I think that being resilient is you learn how to be resilient through life's challenges.
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of quotes about this, but we are so much stronger than we give ourselves credit for, and we can do so much more than we believe we can. And we have to count on human spirit and humanity to, you know, to see through this. I've seen a lot less hatred on social media. I've seen a lot more kind acts than I've seen unkind acts. And I've heard a lot of people who really do want to have hope and optimism. So I totally agree with what you just said.
Yeah. Arlene, you are amazing. I could talk to you for about 12 hours. you're just so gracious to share all of this with us. And I look forward to reading Reinvention. You can buy it online at your online bookstore, anywhere books are sold. That's Arlene's latest book, Reinvention. And you can always catch her on Dragon's Den on CBC and CBC Gem. Thank you so much, Arlene, for sharing your time with us. I really, really appreciate it.
It was my pleasure. Thanks for doing the podcast and keeping people informed. That matters very, very much. So, and I like your basement. It's very cute.
Oh, thank you.
The pictures you have.
Thank you. You know, try to make a basement look nice. All right.
<That's good. laughs>
Thanks, Arlene. And be sure to join us here on TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart every Tuesday and Thursday. Talk to you soon.